So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and welcome to RBI 247. So guys, as you must be knowing that in this series we discuss a set of 5 questions which can be really helpful to you if you are preparing for competitive exams, right? So let's not waste any time and get straight away to the questions. And before doing that, let me ask you to subscribe to our channel. So guys, if you are watching our video for the first time, and so do not forget to subscribe to our channel. It can help you to stay in touch with us. And do not forget to press this bell icon. This bell icon can help you get notified whenever a new video comes up. Right? You can also join our Telegram group for your doubts and queries. You can post them here and we will try to take them up as soon as possible. Moving ahead. Okay, this is your question number 1 for today, which says, have a look at following statements. These statements refer to a particular topic. Could you guess what is being talked about here? So you have to read these statements and tell what are they referring to. Okay. So it simply means lowering the value of a currency, right? So one currency that is being, whose value is being lowered. After that, it was also used to fund wars in the past. Let's see what the solution is. And the correct option for this question is currency debasement. So currency debasement, basically shaking the base of a currency, is known as currency's debasement. If we talk about this topic, simply it means reduction in the value of a currency. See, basically if there is a dress which is worth rupees 1000, if you are able to buy it now with rupees 1000 and after 1 year its price rises to, let's say, 1500, that means rupee has lost its purchasing power, and that is why, keeping the other factors constant, and that is why the currency has lost some of its value, right? So inflation, it eats into the value of a currency. So currency debasement is nothing but lowering the value of a currency. Okay, here you can see. So debasement, traditionally associated with mixing base metals. See guys, if we go into the past, you know that precious metals, they were used as currencies, be it gold, be it silver. So how did governments at that time, they used to debase the currency by mixing their precious metals with some sort of non-precious metals, right? So let's say if there is a country where gold coins, they are being used as currency, right? And these gold coins, they are made up of 100% gold, let's say, right? But the government is thinking to debase the currency. That is why they think that, let's do one thing, let's put 90% gold into the making of the coin and 10% we can put any other metal to reduce the cost of this currency, right? So now the coin, let's say the coin is worth 100. So the coin is worth the same, but earlier it was made up of 100% gold and now it is made up of 90% gold. So the component, the gold component in it has reduced. So its intrinsic value is reduced. What is the meaning of intrinsic value? The value of the component from which the coin is made, right? So intrinsic value is reduced, and this is known as, this was a traditional method of currency debasement when we used to transact in coins made up of precious metals, right? But today, if we talk about today, how can you debase the currency? You can debase the currency by pumping too much of it into the economy or into the market. Because if there is going to be a huge supply of that particular currency, its value is going to go down, right? So, traditionally associated with mixing base metals with currencies that are made up of precious metals. So, mixing, right? In gold and silver, which lowers their value. After that, debasement today refers to government printing more money than the assets they have to back it up, right? Increasing the money supply without a corresponding increase in output. So this has been a popular topic in current times, because we have been suffering from the from outbreak of pandemic, and almost every country in the world, it has gone through some financial distress. That is why it was being cited that countries can print as much as the money that they want, and they can release that money into their economy or put money into the hands of people so that they can generate demand in the market, right? But these steps, they also have their repercussions. It might seem like a very good step, or it might seem like an easy solution, but there are repercussions to it, right? So debasement gives more money to governments for spending, while it results in inflation for the citizens. Obviously, if there is going to be too much money in the economy, it is going to result into inflation. Although it is a good it is a good tool for government to raise funds without even raising the taxes or without cutting their expenditure. Because see, this is the irony. Whenever any economy it is going through some sort of financial distress, or it is going through some problems, government needs to spend more. Basically, if it is going to if the economy is going through demand loss, governments, they need to spend more. They need to spend with an open heart. They need to put money into hands of people to kickstart the economy. But their hands are tied because of their limited capabilities. So this method provides them with unlimited capability, but the problem is it can lead to inflation, because there is going to be too much money into the market, and if it does not, if the money does not reach to some productive uses, then it might be harmful for the entire economy. So by debasing the currencies, government believe they can meet financial obligations, and or they are going to have some more money to spend, but the problem is they eventually lead to a crash. Right? So debasing currency, not a very safe option. So see, it might be a good option in certain circumstances, but the governments or the regulators, they have to take into account the future effects that can happen, right? So if they are thinking of debasing, they should think that whether they will be able to control that money or make that money reach some productive use, right? It should not enter into it should not go into stock market for speculation purposes. Then it might lead to some problems, some more problems for the economy. So debasement, it used to be a popular method of funding wars in earlier times. Government in effect created more money without having to increase taxes, because if you increase taxes, you invite protests from public, or it can obviously lead to shaking of your vote bank. The governments, they do not want that, right? So all these actions are short-sighted, as I just told you that the regulators, they don't have to be short-sighted, because then that can create problems. If they are thinking of debasing, they have to take into account the after effects like inflation. So debasement holds negative consequences for citizenry, primarily in the form of inflation, right? Because there is too much money chasing too less goods. So prices are obviously going to rise, which is going to reduce the purchasing power of a common man, right? So this is about currency debasement. I hope now you are clear with it. Moving ahead. Okay, this is your second question for today, which says, which of the following statement is correct according to the Gresham laws? This is just a second. According to the Gresham law, right? So Gresham law, let's see what the correct answer is. And the correct option for this question is option E, that is bad money, it drives out good money from the circulation. Right. Now you must be wondering, what is the meaning of these two terms, good money or bad money, right? So bad money is something which is not worth its value, whereas good money is something that is worth its value. So if we talk about gold coins, right? So we were just talking that how currencies used to be in the form of gold coins, or they used to be in form of precious metals. So basically their intrinsic value or their component value, the material that has gone into its making, was equal to the value that was put on that particular amount of currency, that particular material that went into making that currency. So for example, if we take a rupee 500 note and on the other hand we take a rupee 2000 note. So basically 2000 rupee note worth 4 times this 500 note, right? But if we talk about their material, material in both of the cases, paper, right? So you think that the paper that is telling you, that is giving you the purchasing power of rupees 100, is that paper worth 500 rupee or is that paper worth 2000 rupee? No, right? So here the component value is not much as compared to the value offered on that particular currency. But if we talk about gold bars, or if we talk about gold coins, their material is actually worth that is being offered on that particular currency, right? People can melt it and then sell that amount of gold or any precious metal that the currency is made up of and use it for other purposes. But you cannot use the paper that has gone into the making of this note for any other purpose, right? So bad money, okay, moving ahead, here you can see. Okay, bad money, currency that is considered to be to equal or less than the intrinsic value as compared to its face value. So which is less than its intrinsic value, just like paper currency, because the material value or the intrinsic value is not equal to its face value or less than it, equal or less than. Whereas good money is the currency that is believed to have a greater intrinsic value or more potential for greater value than its face value, like gold or precious metals, right? So basically, now coming to the Gresham law, I hope you are clear with the terms good money, bad money. Gresham law says that when in an economy there are two types of money, one good money and one bad money, we know the meanings to good and bad. In that case, the bad money is going to be circulated more and this bad money is going to drive out this good money from the market, right? Let's try to take an example to understand this. Diwali is approaching, right? So we all have, we all give gifts to our relatives and friends on this occasion. So many times we gift our relatives and friends some chocolates or some sweets, right? So here, I'm going to talk about two things, Cadbury chocolates and Son Papdi, right? So not many people like Son Papdi. Let us compare it to bad money, because let's say it is not, its worth is less than what is its face value. Whereas Cadbury chocolates, since everybody likes these chocolates, at least most of the people, they like these chocolates. They are good money because their intrinsic value or their component value is more than what is being offered, what is being offered by their face value, right? So now, let's say you get two gift boxes on occasion of Diwali. In one, there are Cadbury chocolates and in the other one, there is Son Papdi. Which one of the following, which one of both of them, do you think you would want to keep with yourself? So basically your mother has asked that you have to pass on one dabba, one box to some other relative and you have to keep one for your own self, right? So which one do you think would you like to keep for yourself and which one do you think you would like to pass on? I think since let's assume that you are a person who likes Cadbury chocolates, then obviously you are going to keep them for your own use and you are going to pass on the Son Papdi box, right? So, and let's say your cousins also think the same way and then everybody is going to pass on Son Papdi and everybody is going to keep the chocolates with themselves for their own use, for their own consumption, right? So, this is going to lead to circulation of Son Papdi in the circle of your relatives or in the circle of your friends, whereas no chocolates are going to be circulated because everybody is thinking that let us keep it for my own use. Right, so the circulation of Son Papdi is going to overshadow the circulation of Cadbury chocolates. So basically bad money is being circulated a lot because no one wants to hoard it and they are putting it into circulation, whereas good money is being hoarded, that is why it is not in the circulation. So bad money getting into circulation and driving out good money. So now try to imagine the same scenario in in finance, right? So let's say there is a country where two types of currencies are popular, right? One gold coins and other silver coins. So let's say this silver coins, they are debased, or let's say this is bad money, right? Whereas gold, they are not debased, their intrinsic value is higher. That is why gold is good money, right? So in that case, if you have an option, right? So government is making no difference. You can spend any one of the two that you want to spend into market for buying goods and services. Since gold is having a higher intrinsic value, you would not want to spend gold to buy things. You would want to spend the silver, which one is debased or which is having a lower value than its intrinsic value. So you are going to think that, okay, let me keep gold for myself, because in future if any problem comes up, I can melt the gold coins and I can use it or I can resell it. It is going to provide me with good money. Whereas the debased currency, you cannot use it. That is why you try to circulate it and you try to buy goods and services with the help of that particular bad money, right? So if this process continues and everyone in the country thinks like you, then everyone is going to circulate the bad money and they are going to hoard the good money for themselves, and the result would be that bad money is going to drive out good money from the market, right? So basically the good money is not going anywhere, but it is being hoarded or stored, right, for future use or for personal consumption. So this is what is being said by Gresham's law, that bad money drives out good money from the market, right? Here you can see, although we have discussed most of the points here, Gresham's law says that legally overvalued currency will tend to drive legally undervalued currency out of circulation. See, the debased currency is the, or the bad money is the overvalued currency, because it is being debased, the component value is less. As I just told you, see, if there is a note on which 2000 is printed, the value is not, the value of the paper is not equal to 2000, but it is just it is just representing 2000 rupees, right? So that means it is overvalued. So the bad money is the overvalued money, which is going to drive out the undervalued or the good money out of circulation. Originated as an observation of the effects of metallic currency debasement, but also applies in today's world of paper and electronic money. Now, if you look at this picture, you can see that this concept, this Gresham's law, is also being talked about in the context of introduction of cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin, because they are not having any kind of intrinsic value. If you have some Bitcoins, if you are buying some Bitcoins, or if you mint some Bitcoins, there is no component value to it. There is no intrinsic value to it. So obviously that is a form of bad money. So if in future, at some later date in life, if Bitcoin drives out the paper currency out of circulation and digital currency takes over, then this Gresham law can be said to be applied here, right? So it can, although it comes from some traditional traditional times, or it comes from the times when metals were used as currencies, but it still continues to the digital currency. So basically it has seen a long journey from metal currency, then to paper currency, then plastic currency, and now to digital currency, right? So one basic assumption for this concept is both the currencies are treated as generally acceptable medium of exchange. They both are easily liquid. See, because if debased currency or if bad money is not liquid, then you might not be able to circulate it. So both should be liquid. These are some basic assumptions for the application of this law, and available for use simultaneously, right? So this is Gresham's law. I hope you understand it. And moving ahead to the next question. Okay, here is your third question for today. And this question says, dash is the difference between face value of money and the cost to produce it, right? So a very simple question, moving ahead to the answer, and the correct option is A, seigniorage. So the difference between, so we have been talking about this paper currency mentioned in 2000 rupee. So the face value is 2000, but the cost of this paper or the cost that has gone into its making, the difference between this cost and 2000 is known as seigniorage, right? Here you can know some more things about seigniorage. So basically, if this is seigniorage is negative, here you can see seigniorage may be counted as positive revenue for government when the money it creates is worth more than it costs to produce. So if the face value is higher and the costing to produce that money is less, then it can act as a revenue for government because it is providing you an asset worth 2000 rupees, but the paper that has gone into its making is not worth so, right? So this is a profit, this is you can say a revenue, positive revenue for government, but obviously it is not free from repercussions. See, if seigniorage is positive, government will make an economic profit, while a negative seigniorage will result in an economic loss, right? So positive seigniorage, that means costing is less and the face value is high. So if seigniorage is positive, government is into profit. If it is negative, government is into loss. That means the costing is high, but the face value offered is less. So in some situations, production of currency result in a loss instead of gain for the government by creating the currency. So as we just discussed, that this might seem like a very easy option, or this might seem like a quick money making option, but this can result into creation of problems for government, because it might lead to inflation if there is too much liquidity in the market. So revenue is often used by governments to finance portion of their expenditure without having to collect taxes. Government uses this to match their expenditures and revenue, because if they increase taxes, then obviously there are going to be protests by the public, or there are going to be some repercussions in relation to their vote bank. So they do not want that. Moving ahead to the next question. Here is your fourth question for today. Okay. This question says, which of the following statement is not correct about rupee cards? Three statements given to you. You have to select the one which is incorrect. Moving ahead to the answer. And the correct option is option B. Option B means only three is incorrect. Rest two are correct. Guys, if you remember in a recent session, we discussed in the session called tokenization, we discussed how the payments are processed and who are different parties, right? So one entity that we discussed were card payment networks. So if you own a card, an ATM card, you must have seen written on it Visa or MasterCard, right? And if someone has a very recent card, you might be able to see rupee written on it. So these are entities that provide network to complete the transaction. Let's say if you have an SBI card, then and you are making payment to someone. So you are having your account at SBI and you are having a card that belongs to SBI, and you are making a payment to someone who has a bank account at HDFC Bank and possesses the net banking facilities of that particular bank. So the transaction that has to be made between both of these banks, and there are so many banks, there are so many net providers of banking services, and so basically we need a medium to carry out the transaction, and the transaction that intermediary is usually provided by these card payment networks. Basically this field is dominated by MasterCard, Visa, there are Discovery cards also, American Express, but this rupee is an Indian system which provides the entire digital infrastructure to complete the transactions, online financial transactions, right? So rupee is an Indian domestic card scheme launched by NPCI. Both of the statements are correct. Rupee works to enable electronic payment at selected Indian banks and financial institutions. So this is not correct. the correct point should be that it enables payment at all Indian banks and financial institutions. So recently, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman, she has been asking banks to promote RuPay card. So basically, they are saying if anyone comes to you and asks you to give them a new ATM card, then you have to issue a RuPay card, right? See, banks, they have contacts with these network providers and they basically act as intermediary between different bank accounts, because you don't know. So let's say I'm paying at Myntra, I might be having an HDFC card, I might be having a Bank of Baroda card. So I don't know where the money is going, which bank is it, or to which entity that money is going, who is processing that payment. That is why we need intermediaries who can connect different parties involved in a transaction, right? So, Nirmala Sitharaman, she recently asked banks to promote RuPay cards because they think that there is no need for providing Visa or MasterCard to beginners or to people who are using cards for the first time. We must provide them with RuPay cards so that RuPay grows and one day it becomes an international network just like its competitors. So, this is obviously going to affect the business of Visa and MasterCard in India. So, Nirmala Sitharaman, as the first option to customers. So, this statement came on last Tuesday, to only issue RuPay cards as the first option to customers and to seed all bank accounts with Aadhaar number wherever necessary with PAN number by December this year. So they need to link the accounts with Aadhaar number. Government launched RuPay in an effort to promote causes of financial inclusion in the country. So financial inclusion was the basic objective, basic goal behind this, behind the launch of RuPay, right? And introduced in by Indian banking system to reduce the monopoly of foreign gateways. So, as I just told you, if Indian banks, they are going to promote RuPay, it is going to affect the business of foreign monopolies like Visa and MasterCard. And one point is, since they are foreign companies, their commission is very high, their cost of transaction is high, which RuPay can provide at lower costs, right? So, promotion of RuPay. Okay, this is the last question for today, which says recently SEBI proposed extending risk management committee clause to top dash listed companies from 500 at present. So SEBI recently came out with a consultation paper in which we talked about the risk management committee clause, and they are suggesting that currently top 500 companies, they are required to comply with it and we should extend it to dash companies. The correct option for this question is option C. Option C means top 1000 companies. See, risk management clause is an important clause because I think in this year this has been evident that risks and threats can come anytime, and businesses need to be prepared for that. They need to stress test themselves. That means they need to check their resilience, that if any bad thing happens to them, whether they will be able to survive or not, right? So risk management committee is very essential to businesses, and there is need of comprising it of good people, of competent people who can frame such policies that can make businesses strong. So risk management committee, they should meet at least twice a year. Currently they meet once a year, and it should be increased to twice a year. Basically, SEBI is stressing the importance of risk management committee. Considering the multitude of risks faced by listed entities. See, why is it important to talk about the top companies? Because they are systemically important, and if anything bad happens to them, it affects the entire industry. Do you remember what happened with IIFS? Because of this one huge debacle, NBFCs have been facing problem till date, right? So that is why to prevent that spillover effect from big entities. So the bigger the entity, the more interconnected it is, the more effect it can have on the entire market or entire industry. That is why it is important to analyze the magnitude of risk that is being faced by such entities. So, according to the regulator, risk management committee would formulate a detailed risk management policy. So, this committee would have to make a policy which would include framework for identification of internal and external risks. So, internal risk can be like anything that goes into the management of company, anything that is inefficient that can be changed. And so internal factors are within the control of the entity or the organization, but external risks, they are not under the control. So pandemic came and no one was able to control it. So no business can control it, no matter how much prepared they are, but at least they can reduce their internal problems and they can try to prepare for this external risk, which they cannot avoid, they have to face. But if prepared, it will be easier to face them. So risk include financial, operational, sectoral, sustainability risks. And so this cyber security aspect is one major aspect in current times, right? Especially with most of the staff of companies working from home, they especially need to be strong in the cybersecurity area. Committee should be responsible for taking measures for risk mitigation, how to control risks, and business contingency plan. So I think we have discussed the meaning of business contingency plan in one of our previous session, as well as supervising and implementation of risk management policy. So only policy making is not enough, its execution, its proper implementation is also important, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you found it beneficial. And if you did, then do not forget to hit the like button. I will be back in next session with some more information. Till then, you take care of your health. Keep your studies going on. And I'll see you in the next session. Thank you for being here.